1919, Charles Kettering, one of the fathers of precision guidance, had this to say about his brainchild. What is regarded as one of the most destructive weapons invented during the war has been placed in the secret archives of the War Department of Washington. There to remain, it is hoped, even by the inventor, for all times. Dire words to describe a flimsy biplane whose first flight ended miserably. But this was the world's first smart bomb. World War I pilots experienced for the first time the stark equation of aerial bombing. Precision equals proximity to the target. But the closer you get to the enemy, the better your chances of getting shot out of the sky.
General rule is if the target is worth destroying by us, it's worth protecting by the enemy. So any target you're going after is probably going to be fairly heavily defended.
The only way to stem the carnage was to start removing the pilot from the equation, to make a remote-controlled bomb. This is the so-called aerial torpedo, a prototype for a guided weapon invented in 1918 for the U.S. Navy. Not to be outdone, the Army appealed to an inventor and future president of General Motors.
They went to Charles F. Kettering and asked him if he could develop something similar for them.
Officially still called an aerial torpedo, the bomb was nicknamed the Kettering Bug. The Bug was a hybrid chemical weapon with a 200-pound payload of high explosives and mustard gas. A wing and motor assembly was fitted onto the warhead. For a runway, a short section of dolly track. After its first crashes, Kettering's Bug finally flew. The fluttering you see is caused by continuous steering input from gyroscopic stabilizers. Range was controlled by an odometer that counted propeller revolutions. When it reached a preset distance, up to 75 miles, the ignition was killed and the bomb dove. But there were a great many bugs in Kettering's Bug, which was unreliable in testing and deployed too late for combat.
In its day, it was the most fearsome weapon imaginable. Falling from the skies with unparalleled fury, it caused death and destruction far out of proportion to its size. The Nazis called it their vengeance weapon. Its legacy was man's first glimpse of a grim future as hostage to nuclear terror. Launched with a powerful steam catapult from slotted steel rails about 150 feet long, V-1s rained on their targets from distant camouflaged sites in Normandy and East Prussia. A tube with a reaction chamber and a short steel piston was mounted underneath the platform's narrow track. A device called a starter trolley shot gas into the tube, which in turn propelled the piston forward. The piston was equipped with a lug which protruded through the track slot and was attached to the V1. In 3/4 of a second, the V1 was accelerated to nearly 250 miles an hour. This launch assembly, brought to England at the end of World War II, is now exhibited at the Imperial War Museum in Duxford. Powered by an unorthodox pulse jet propulsion system, the rocket's simple airframe and stubby wings bore a large warhead. Guided by an unpredictable autopilot, its inaccuracy made it all the more terrifying. From safe havens on the continent, the V1, or more accurately, the Fieseler FI-103, made killing a cold and detached exercise. For the first time, people in a foreign land could be destroyed by remote control. Out of the V1 was a pair of spherical air bottles. These supplied the power for the gyroscopes, autopilot, and fuel injection system. Valves directed the air to its various destinations. An electrical interface and pneumatic system controlled the V1 in flight. Twin pneumatic servos moved the control surfaces. This pneumatic servo system was actuated by the autopilot. The V1 was moved by hand onto the cradle and launch rail. Once in position, the compressed air hose and electrical connection were the only umbilicals required. With an explosive shove, The missile was moving at 360 feet per second by the time it left the ramp. A three-position switch ignited the jet and kicked in the catapult system. The switch, when moved to the intermediate position, pushed the pulse jet to maximum throttle. 7 seconds later, pressure in the catapult became intense enough to shear off a 6mm holding pin, releasing the missile support cradle. In less than a second, the deadly flying bomb was airborne. Its flight profile was simple, virtually a straight line from launch to destination, which made the V-1 vulnerable. But once over the target, with its fuel shut off, it began its earthward dive. With the push of a button, thousands of V-1s were launched from hundreds of sites scattered across Nazi-occupied territory. The Argus AS-109 pulse jet engine was essentially a welded steel tube with an inlet grille supporting a set of spring-loaded steel flaps. Between the flaps were atomizers which sprayed fuel into the combustion chamber. A spark plug ignited the fuel as it was injected. This created a sound that was unforgettable for the many Dutch and British citizens who survived V-1 attacks.
In 1944, an unknown flying object attacked London. Mysteriously, it seemed to know exactly when it reached the city and just fell out of the sky. The German V-1, the so-called buzz bomb, was designed to terrorize Britain.
"London is doomed," said Dr. Goebbels.
While Londoners wonder what had hit them, a U.S. officer is busy finding out. Hap Arnold had worked on the Kettering Bug, the world's first cruise missile built 26 years earlier.
Hap Arnold went to London right after the D-Day invasion, and while he's staying on the suburbs in a house on the southwest part of London, about 5:30 in the morning, the first buzz bombs come over, and he's awakened by them going off, and they're hitting about a mile and a half from where he's staying. Later in the day, he takes the opportunity to go out and actually visit one of these buzz bomb sites. And he goes to the thing, he sees the bits and pieces, and he quickly understands they've taken a bomb and stuck it on the front of some sort of an aircraft.
The tangled wreckage concealed important clues about how this amazing weapon found its target. Hap Arnold collected all the pieces he could find and shipped them back to the U.S.
This is what Hap Arnold would have seen, is bits and pieces like this. Actually, he even talks about seeing bits of the nose cone and the wings were pretty much gone, but the tail surface was still available to him. It's always bigger than it looks in the pictures, isn't it?
That's it. With that big dent on top of it, too.
I guess it hit the ground hard?
Yeah.
From battered parts like these, American engineers began to reverse engineer Hitler's secret weapon. 3 weeks later, they cracked it. The V-1 had a simple yet powerful jet engine, which accelerated it to an incredible 400 miles an hour. But the most important riddle the Americans solved was how the V-1 knew when to drop. A propeller at the tip of the missile turned as it moved through the air. Each revolution was counted by an odometer in the tail section. At a preset mileage, a guillotine cut the pneumatic hoses to the rudder, locking it in position. Two detonators then ejected a set of spoilers, disrupting the airflow under the elevators and sending the V-1 into a steep dive. Called the Doodlebug, the V-1 was only accurate enough to hit a city the size of London. Good enough for the Germans.
Robot bombs damaged or destroyed 800,000 English buildings in 6 weeks. Over 1 million people have been evacuated from the city of London.
The But how could a speeding missile navigate between 16 targets many miles apart?
One of our guys, Bill Hallmark, came up with the idea that every piece of ground has got a unique fingerprint.
Using topographic maps, Bill Hallmark and his team translated the valleys and ridges of the landscape into a digital map and uploaded it into the SLAM's computer. They called their invention Fingerprint. SLAM would bounce a radar beam off the terrain it was flying over and compare it to the map stored in its memory. This is how it would zero in on its targets. The government killed the SLAM project in 1964 and put the fingerprint technology on the shelf. But when work began on the Tomahawk in the 1970s, it was rediscovered and transplanted into this missile, where it works to this day. Radar navigation gives the missile another amazing feature, stealth. As the Tomahawk reaches the coast, it drops down to evade enemy radar. Hugging the landscape tightly, it speeds along at nearly 500 miles an hour, just 50 feet off the ground. It's a truly amazing feat of flying, and all without a pilot. Some would even say no human could possibly match the skill of a cruise missile. While radar navigation in a cruise missile never gets tired, it does have one weakness. It needs geographic features to lock onto. That is why the cruise missiles in Desert Storm didn't attack Baghdad head-on. U.S. mission planners had feared their Tomahawks would get lost over the flat and featureless deserts of Iraq. So instead, they chose to fly them the long way around over the Zagros Mountains of Iran. Once the Tomahawk zeroes in on its target, it will strike with extreme precision. But how does it know exactly when to attack?
Production of robot bombs in American factories, an adaptation of the German V-1.
U.S. engineers tried to turn the V-1 into a high-precision weapon, but they couldn't.
From the launching platform, a robot goes whizzing.
The American robot bombs still missed their targets by over 8 miles. The modern Tomahawk is 1,000 times more accurate. First, it takes a photo of the target area and compares it to a digital photo in its computer memory. Then a GPS signal guides the missile into the target. Once locked on, a Tomahawk hits within an accuracy of 10 yards. Some say it could even fly through a window. But what if the target is invisible, sheltered beneath thick layers of earth and armored concrete?